diawasi oleh juga Residensi Project atau BIMP dan teman-teman dari Kecil Bergerak. Mereka memfasilitasi mereka berdua. Kemudian Jodoh dan Hana ini berproses di Kampung Larangan, terutama di Bantaran Kali Jobe bersama
Wakul ya, seperti yang ini kita ini
untuk membuat taman yang dari barang-barang bekas, terus mengolah tanah yang di bantaran kali itu. Dan kali ini mereka akan menerangkan proyek mereka. Ada Mbak Rere juga akan menemani ngobrol, ada Mbak Aris dari BIMP juga menemani, dan sama teman-teman itu bergerak, kami dan orang-orang juga akan menerangkan diskusi. Jadi silakan aja selanjutnya langsung diskusi dalam bahasa Inggris, Mbak Aris. Nanti kalau ada kesulitan bisa dibantu yang lain. Kalau kita bertanya dalam bahasa Inggris, ya kan? Seperti mana?
This is a photo of one of the first jump playgrounds. I think this one's in England, right?
The most radical product of the post-war investment in play is the adventure playground. In conscious contrast to the traditional equipment-based playground with its four S's, boxes like instruments which provide primarily a kinetic physical mode of gratification. The adventure playground has no ready-made play equipment. Children are given an empty space, construction tools and waste material. The playground is a work in progress, a product of their activity and inventiveness. It engages the players with the pleasure of making things as well as destroying them. The divergence from the more repetitive forms of play, mechanical play equipment facilitates. Literally anything that seemed usable was brought back to the playground as a resource. This form of urban recycling was an important part of the adventure play aesthetic. There is an image which sort of illustrates the sorts of materials that are typically used in a jump playground. This one is in London. It's probably from the 60s or so, I believe. So tires, lots of doors and windows, construction, lumber, salvaged from houses that were pulled down, and things like that.
The idea was that children build their own playground. So they were given access to tools, and there was a supervisor, a play worker, who watched them. And then they were encouraged to build whatever they want out of these materials with minimum direction. This is a quote that we quite like that sums up the difference between the adventure playground and the conventional playground.
Promoters of the adventure playground argue that the imagination of play should be that of the child, not the architect. And this tower you can see there is from the very first jump playground, which was set up during World War II in Nazi-occupied Copenhagen. So it was commissioned by that architect who first came up with the idea of jump playgrounds. And there was quite an influential American play worker, so sort of supervisor, who was a bit of a philosopher and an artist and had a funny way of looking at the world, I guess, and saw that playground come into existence for its first, I think, 10 years or so.
And that tower, this 5-story sign, was built entirely by kids.
Yeah.
Pretty impressive.
Cool. So this is John Bertelsen, the American who was the first play supervisor as the very first jump playground in Copenhagen.
I guess, yeah, so he saw the playgrounds as a form of comment on the outside world. I guess he sort of saw the children as being capable of making a judgment on their environment through their building behaviors, and was very into taking children's actions seriously, and saw that, yeah, as the quote says, he saw the playground as a form of data aesthetics. He was interested in the way that the building of the children resembled post-war art movements and the kind of jumbled aesthetic of reassembling material from the machine world and, yeah, compiling it in different ways.
Bertelsen depicted is the realization of data aesthetics, in which the playful and collective reassembling of the leftovers of the machine civilization presented an alternative conception of architecture, where the unmediated act of building is seen as a direct expression of the values and desires of the residents. His emphasis on the strangeness of children's creations coincided with the aesthetic sensibility of post-war avant-garde art movements, such as Art Group, Cobber, and the Independence Group, which made use of leftover materials, coarse techniques, and childlike or primitive imagery to use raw, crude visual images. And we like that picture a lot.
Yeah, so part of the thing that attracted us to this form of playground originally was the idea that children are shaping their environment directly through their own actions, and that in doing so, it's a bit, I don't know, it has a sort of an anarchist overtone of a lack of control and a lack of pre-planning, and that that in this kind of disordered spaces, there is room to envision other ways of building, other ways of inhabiting space and cities. And I guess, yeah, a lot of these playgrounds, or all of these playgrounds, were built in the context of kind of modernist urbanism. As you can see, a lot of the photos have these modernist housing blocks behind, and they were partially a reaction against this very formalized, very one-size-fits-all ideas of what living in the city would be like. And they were much more open-ended and uncertain as to what the best way of living collectively was.
And specifically in England, the jump playgrounds came out of the way children were playing on bomb sites in London, I guess mostly during the Second World War. Like the adventure playgrounds that they helped to inspire, bomb sites provided a wealth of materials and spaces for children to explore different forms of play and other activities. The disorder and adaptability of urban ruins and the abundance of bricks and timber meant that the children could manipulate the very topography of the sites to fit their individual imaginations and collective endeavours.
And in a lot of ways, that kind of approach seems like a really early example of this drive towards the idea of consulting the people who are going to be living in the space and letting them make decisions rather than looking at experts to design urban spaces. And it's, I guess, to get children to design their own space feels like taking that a step further, and that children are probably the last people to be consulted. And this is a quote from an anarchist geographer called Colin Moore, who really liked his description.
Colin Ward describes the adventure playground as a kind of parable of anarchy, a free society in miniature that realized Kropotkin's ideal of a society to which pre-established forms crystallized by law are repugnant, which looks for harmony in an ever-changing and fugitive equilibrium between a multitude of varying forces and influences of various kinds following their own course.
Yeah, I guess as opposed to this is a video of from a playground in London. This was what got us first interested in this form of playground. It really shows this kind of idea of a free society in miniature. There's lots of people running around doing their own thing with very little control, and it's chaos, but somehow it's quite beautiful and it seems to work very well.
And it also, I guess, the video also highlights a little the urban context that these playgrounds were set in.
It's a long video, but we'll just show you the first few minutes.
Is that a song?
Yeah, it does. Is that the new problem?
Enjoyed by well-to-do tenants of the surrounding flats, a legacy of Victorian villages. North Kensington is the victim of long years of neglect by the Borough Council. Landlords too have sucked it to the bone. Citizens' action groups are everywhere. Most people are cynical and distrustful of politics and have no wish to be involved. But changes must come about, and they're starting with the children. There's now a play program run on temporary sites by volunteers in all the time, and it's growing. The oldest, and until recently the only recurrent play site, is the Notting Hill Adventure Playground. Kids from all over flock to the playground. They call it the Venture. Just celebrates the arrival of summer with a carnival, like its neighborhood.
Yeah, I guess we like this video for a few reasons. Like, it shows it's got a strong discourse about urban justice and public space, which I think remains really relevant today. And it also sort of shows, I guess, there's a word in Indonesian that I think so is telling us about Bogota. I think that he said it's kind of like a translation of urbanism, but it more means about making the city alive. And I think I like how this video shows this real animating of space. Yeah, in this particular context, there was a real emphasis on construction as the main activity of the playgrounds, and it was perceived as a bit of an allegory for post-war reconstruction, both physical and reconstruction of society after the trauma of the Second World War.
As this quote mentions, a lot of, in the context of London, a lot of the jump playgrounds were built on bomb sites. As in that last video you saw, that last shot panning across the playground, that was all constructed by the children. And promoters of these playgrounds saw them as a hopeful or beautiful allegory for the rebuilding of society following the war. And in the context of our project here in Jogja, we're both attracted to that notion of this specific type of playground as an allegory. But it's a very different context, of course, than the post-war European context. And being from Australia, we're not in a position to provide the allegory that can go along with the playground that we're setting up together with this camp home that I might have. So the allegory is something I guess we're still slowly trying to tease out of the project, and that is something we'd like the children to sort of bring out of the project.
I think, a lot of the urban issues in contemporary Jogja are of course very different from those of post-war Europe, but I think that nonetheless the idea of shaping your city and about what that means and how children envisage the future of their city is a relevant one. And yeah, we're interested in how it develops and how this, the meaning that what can be read into our project and how that's different from the original, how that translation comes about.
Yes, so we wanted to set up a playground as a bit of a laboratory, which an allegory can, in which we can experiment with an allegory, but the allegory itself has to come from the children.
Yeah, that was the background of this is the sort of thing that we were reading about and watching before we came. And I guess from now on, we're talking more about the actual project that we've been doing here in Jogja. So I guess we start off by explaining a little bit about where we've been working. This is a picture of the site. At this stage, I guess we've been working in the living Ragnar farm maybe 3 weeks or so. This is before we started building the playground proper, but we've started collecting materials, as you can see, and done some excavation. That area there originally was kind of landfill. The space itself is it's three separate titles, and it's an interesting space as well because it's owned by outside people from the kampung. Like there are three people who own each block, but they bought it some time ago. 16 years ago, and in that time, it's been left as investment property, and the community, yeah, there were houses. So before it was housing area for the kampung, and then each lot got sold, and the houses were demolished. But it's been left somewhat in limbo over the past 16 years. It can be sold at any time, but at this stage, the community has loose access to it if they're building impermanent structures or using it in ways that aren't, yeah, making lasting changes.
So you can see in the foreground there where the tires are the foundations of one of the houses that was demolished 16 years ago. In the middle space where the futsal court is has always been an empty space like that. And it's been used by the community for a long time for recreation. And then beyond the futsal court is our friend Elsa and his father Hugh's dwelling. Yeah, their house is considered temporary, so they're allowed to dwell on this is the third lot of land out of these three lots.
So mostly, yeah, these two. I guess our project's been in the two closest lots in the footage. And this area here is kind of mostly like a waste site. It's a lot of dust and dirt, but also a lot of rubbish. And then we did a lot of digging around there and been bagging up the banks. There was some banana palms, and it's sort of the kids played there already, but there wasn't so much there. And then that middle square was used and still is used as for sport and also for events and things as a community space.
This is looking the other way up the bank. So just beyond the banana palms at the top of the shop is the street, and over the street is the Hotel Lilia, Helsani. There are some wild woods there past the banana palms as well. We've begun to do some sort of excavation, I suppose, or archaeology.
Pretty lo-fi excavation meaning us with shovels.
Which was an unexpectedly enjoyable part of the project. I guess we didn't know in advance that we'd be dealing with all of this dirt and rubbish as well. But it was really fun. It continues to be fun, I guess. An ongoing part of the project. And all of those bags that you can see on the left there is dirt shoveled out from just beyond the tires there where the foundations of one of the houses is that were mostly buried.
So yeah, this is, I guess, for the first two or three weeks that we were in the campung, up until Independence Day, we were making those garden beds, and then ended up being mostly Jorgenad making a lot of bags. And it was a really nice sort of slow process of digging and searching, because it's quite hard to shovel up the rubbish, so you're sort of separating things out and you find all kinds of interesting things. It really shows all of the packaging is one use shampoo sachets intermingled with plastic bags and roots and all these systems, and it's sort of, you know, because it was a very repetitive action of shoveling for several hours at a time, your mind kind of wandered, you'd start thinking about how all of these things are connected and all of the different histories and origins of this packaging that's just been left there. And it kind of, I don't know, it's provided kind of an interesting material history of the campung itself, the way people are using different materials.
So this is I guess it was only after, on the left hand side, this is sort of, just the surface of the dirt that we've been digging up, and some of the various objects, as Hannah mentioned, that provide a bit of a history, a material history of the camp, or what's being consumed, what's being regarded. And it was only subsequent to all of this digging that I sort of became interested in contemporary archaeologies and archaeology that deals with material that's not so old and ruins that are not very old as well. And another interest, I guess, has been looking rather fixatedly at objects and all the different, all the wonders of objects, I guess. This is a quote from one of the sort of contemporary archaeology books that I've been reading, talking specifically, it's about Heidegger, and it's about, it's actually about art, but I feel like every time art is mentioned, you can replace it with the word rubbish, and it sort of, it works really well as well. And for me, it sums up quite well why I'm attracted to art and what I see in rubbish as well. And I guess one thing that's been important for Hannah and I throughout the project, when we're kind of trying to emphasize with people, is we've been, as much as possible, I guess we've been using junk materials or recycled materials. But we wanted to get away from a discourse about the way to recycle materials and to give materials value again. And to
gentrify recycling.
Yeah. And rather than think about what's so wonderful about the uselessness of rubbish, I guess, and how that usefulness is wonderful and poetic, I guess, is the main thing, that the uselessness of the rubbish has a real poetic quality. So I'll read the quote, because I think it's a nice link between art and rubbish. It's talking about art. Think about rubbish. The objects we deal with day to day appear transparent to us. If we ask what kinds of things they are, the answer is to be found in the use we make of them. These objects may even become so transparent that we lose sight of them as thieves. We deal with them so familiarly that we tend to overlook them. They have become a matter of habit to such an extent that we only have eyes for what we use them for. Their thing character disappears in usefulness. The works of art open before us a world that is wider than the one limited to usefulness and service. They teach us to see more of the world we inhabit than we have eyes for in our practical life. So if you say, the junk opens for us a world that is wider than the one limited to usefulness and service. The junk teaches us to see more of the world we inhabit than we have eyes for in our practical life. I think it works.
And I guess we noticed with the way that children are playing, that children seem quite attuned to this, like, animating objects as they are without needing to fix a use for them. They become interested in things, anything lying around, and can can see it in flames as something else and attribute some purpose to it and then forget about that immediately and discard it and leave it. And they seem, yeah, much less fixated on this kind of instrumentalized approach to things.
So on the right side is some art that I was making with junk that was collected in receipts and cardboard from a recycling shop nearby, and also like an old bank leaflet or something from somebody also procured from a recycling shop nearby. And a quote on the left-hand side that I think sums up nicely one of the reasons why we're interested in children's play. Children in their play are able to recognize the most unexpected potentials in the most futile of things. The child's recognition of things is, moreover, never exhaustive. The thing will always hold in reserve other unknown potentials, which may light up in new contexts and new games and uselessness, therefore, has no place in their intuitive relationship to the world of things.
Yeah, so, okay, and this is a little bit of a shift, but another thing that we found that we really drew on from the adventure playgrounds and that we've tried to carry on throughout our approach to the project and to the children is this idea that the children are innately, they're constructive of their own accord, and they don't need to be guided, and that if you just let them be and don't direct them too much, they'll do interesting and valuable things and come up with ideas and execute them in ways that suit their own needs. And I guess part of our approach to the kids has been to just take them seriously as people and not to try and put them in a separate category. I find it really interesting in that, I guess, yeah, I'm hanging out with kids a lot of Ramakan, and often like, adults will say, oh, you really like children, and actually before this I haven't had so much to do with children and I don't have like a particular predisposition towards them, but these kids are really good and they're my friends. And I think part of this is, yeah, the idea that if you don't act in this kind of teacher or parent role, which luckily enough we're very much free from in this project, and if you're just able to relate to children as people and give them, have faith in them in some way, have like give them the respect to a chance to do what they want to do, that the results are pretty interesting.
So here on the left hand side is a building that has since become a cafe, that some of the boys aged around 12 or 13 built. And then there's a bit of a loft at the top there where you can see them sitting, and then a plastic flat wrap roof. And the cafe down the bottom is, maybe you mentioned quickly the cafe.
Yeah, so I'll just get to that. So I guess, yeah, here's a couple more pictures of, I guess, kids just getting absorbed. We really wanted to let the kids get absorbed in their own activities and just leave a lot of opportunities and support them in kind of making those activities bigger and sustaining their interest before they get frustrated. So here's a picture of one of our friends doing hammering bits and pieces together, and another picture of this cafe that these boys built and that our friend Elva runs on the weekend. So yeah, with relating to the kids, I guess we're pretty interested in this kind of participatory approach, but when we try more conventional participatory art things, like for example, to begin with, we did the thing of, okay, we're going to build this playground together, what would you like your playground to look like? This is probably quite a standard thing. We got them to draw pictures because language is not so good and children often like to communicate with pictures. And some of it worked, but this picture here is Jorgen had a bit of a design that he thought of some ideas that he liked and showed the kids and said, okay, now what would you like to see? And with Risky over there, who was translating, trying to ask them, you know, what would you like to see in your playground? And mostly they drew pretty much the same thing as Jorgen's picture. One way or another, they were like, their default, I guess, was maybe to copy or to emulate that. And we got some interesting results, but a lot of the time it felt somewhat tokenistic, like we were reaching out to them and trying to attract their attention. And so after that, we kind of changed our methodology a bit and became more interested in just trying things out and then testing reactions and being open to adapting our ideas as people reacted. So for example, one of the parts of the project that I found really interesting was negotiating the flying fox. One of the first things when we built the first construction phase, we had some carpenters and built some basic things like some platforms and a slide and a flying fox, and that happened quite quickly. And I guess growing up in Australia, having a flying fox is quite a normal thing. I was on many flying foxes as a kid that parents, friends and things had built. But in Georgia, no one seemed to have ever tried a flying fox before, and people were quite alarmed. It's quite high and quite fast, and the immediate reaction was a bit nervous. And I guess it's a good example of how we've been sort of negotiating with the community as we go, in that although they were kind of a little bit uncomfortable, people were quite all right with, like, us testing it gradually and adapting it until everyone was comfortable with it. And I really enjoyed that process. For example, I guess first the carpenter tested it, and then I tested it, and then our friend Ursa, who we worked with the most in the temple, and then gradually kids tested it, and some people fell off. And we were like, oh, everyone's going to freak out. But instead, like, everyone was always watching. This space is very, it's a communal space, and there are always people from the warungs looking down the street, or people coming in from their houses, or people walking past, and there's this constant sense of latent supervision. And people would stand there and look and be like, and then occasionally they would offer advice, or they'd say, you know, I think you need to add some rope here to make it stronger. Or as they were giving these suggestions, people keep testing it, even more than I was comfortable with. Sometimes people would, you know, after someone fell off, they would be like, okay, now we try again. And I guess this kind of sums up how our negotiation process has gone. It's rather than us all coming to an agreement before something happens, it's mostly been, we test things and then we continue to talk about them, and then eventually there is a result that people are comfortable with. And yeah, that felt much more kind of meaningful, I guess, than the planning of the project with the kids beforehand. Got anything to add?
Yeah, so I guess in a lot of socially engaged art, or whatever you want to call it, collaboration is a big word. It's another way of saying the same thing, was that this attempt to elicit plans and opinions from the children was a real conventional approach to collaboration / participation. That felt sort of, yeah, tokenistic, as we mentioned. It didn't feel entirely real, and like it was a little bit too politically correct. And it's not the way I generally work, I think. I'm usually, I don't know, I like to get a response in a different way, and that, yeah, the flying fox is one example of, well, kind of after that we moved on and just started building things, and then collaboration was not something that we sort of tried to monitor at each stage of the way, or that was where everyone was expected to be on the same page the entire time. But rather, the idea was to sort of put something out there and then wait for a response from people from the community, from the children or whatever, and that it's sort of worked in a back and forth way like that. And it doesn't always work. Sometimes there's not much of a response or whatever. But for us, it felt like a more real way of
collaborating.
Yeah.
And I guess even making that work is the fact that there's not really, we're not in any position of authority, we're in no way experts. For example, particularly, I mean, we haven't built something like this before, for one thing, but also there are a lot of things about the way that the campon works and the way that things that we need to know around this work, we just don't know. And so we're constantly asking for advice, and people are directing the way that things, yeah, we're approaching people and getting their help. And I think that's been really helpful in creating a more even relationship. And I guess my favourite example from this has been this cafe that our friend Elva runs. So she wanted to sell food in the playground. And we thought that was a pretty cool idea. So we agreed that we would, gave her a bit of a budget, and she would run this cafe.
herself the way that she wanted to. And she told me three things she wanted to make, and actually I didn't know how to make any of them. So we go to Pasta Brinjajo, it's like the market nearby Ravnica, and we do this a few days a week, every week, and her and a friend and me, and then usually actually I'm just there to supervise because she's 10, so she's not allowed to go on her own. But other than that, I do very little. She's doing the negotiating herself because I get all their prices. She's the one who can speak Indonesian. She's the one who knows what ingredients are needed. She manages the money and says, okay, no, we're not making this because it's too expensive, and carries it out the whole way. And I guess one of the things that I like most about this kind of a project is that it encourages you to take the back step and see what people can do. And if there are things that she can't do, then you support her. But generally, that doesn't happen. And I think, this kind of like lack of authority or lack of expertise can make quite interesting interactions with kids. And this is a quote from the original playground about how a play leader works, because I guess another defining feature of this form of playground is that it was always supervised by someone. There was always someone there consistently who was kind of working with the kids, but always with a back from behind and low intervention.
I consider it most important that the leader should not appear too clever, but that he remain at the same experimental stage as the children. In this way, the initiative is left, to a great extent, with the children themselves, and it is thus far easier to avoid serious intrusion into their fantasy world. We were, as Hannah mentioned, we were attracted to this methodology. And one thing working in this context that's made it easier for us to adopt that methodology is the fact that we don't share a language with the children, and that we're really at a much lower experimental stage than they are, because we can't speak Indonesian. And that's also allowed us not to intrude into their fantasy world, and not to, because it's often difficult, I think, not to end up sort of directing children's activities, and that kind of fortuitously the fact that we don't speak Indonesian means that it's been difficult for us to direct children's activities in group one too.
We kept somewhat separate from what's going on. We don't know a lot of the time, when we figure out later. We're always sort of trying to keep up, and that keeps us a bit behind.
So I think this slide was supposed to go earlier. Again, it's about collaboration. And it's a quote by Abdul Malik Simon, an urbanist we like a lot, who's done a lot of work in Jakarta, specifically in kampungs, and has talked about collaboration as something that happens, often unintentionally and subconsciously between actors in the urban environment. And we felt that if there was collaboration in our project between ourselves and the community, it sort of mimicked the collaboration that he suggests happens between residents of kampung communities. Collaboration is implicit, more a kind of underneath of things than an intentional practice.
We've got some photos here of a party that the youth of the community threw for our friend Angus, who came and visited for a couple of weeks and then left, and he made a lot of friends in the community, and the Pemuda threw a party partially for him and partially to open the playground. This is a month or so ago now. But it was nice because for us it sort of came out of nowhere. I think they were talking about it late at night, and the next day they said, okay, we want to have this party for the children, and we'll throw a coloured flower at each other, sort of like a Hindu festival. And then when it came, it was sort of, we were all day, we were making this coloured flower, it was very quiet and slow process, and then out of nowhere there is a DJ booth and people hosing things down and very loud, obnoxious music and everyone running around, and it's this big crazy thing that we have nothing to do with, and that is, it's a different kind of collaboration, but it works really well. Things bounce off each other, and we kind of like that as...
Yeah, it was unscripted.
Yeah.
comes with the collaboration of an effort to ensure collaboration is there at all stages of the project.
So I guess, yeah, another form of like collaboration is partially with the community, but then also, I guess a lot of our the project is involved looking for materials and trying to find things, given that we are interested in working with recycled materials. One of our most useful contacts has been this recycling shop, which is up on the street next to the Lapwangan where we're making the playground. And we became kind of friendly with them. We buy things from them often, and they have a lot of connections throughout the city, and so we would ask for something in particular, and they're able to source it from friends in their communitas and able to get us sometimes large quantities of strange things if we ask. And we went and visited their warehouse as well. So different ways that they're collecting materials. Often, I guess, people bring things to them, like scavenge different materials, and then they order it and sell it on either as recycling or back out to people like us who want it as it is.
This is the kids' fun adventure island in the top floor of the program shopping mall that you're most likely all familiar with. And it's about 100 meters away from our playground, I guess. And I guess the idea of this juxtaposition was we were trying to tease out the ways we think our playground is a little different to this one.
So I guess, like in a lot of ways, if you look at the playground that we're making in Rakhankan, it has a lot of different things going on. It's very colourful and there are many different bits and pieces, and at times it can be quite chaotic. But we were thinking today about how it's different from this playground of sorts, which is very high stimulation and sort of, I guess, instant gratification. It's very like flashing lights and quick things, and everything can be used once. And I guess this is perhaps the consumeristy playground. And I guess one thing that we thought was interesting is that it's designed for you to take the kids there and leave them, and then everything is set up already and they just use things. It doesn't require any kind of investment, and in that way it doesn't provide any sense of ownership. It's something to be used, it's a service. I guess to juxtapose this, the forms of play that you're most interested in often are ones that are just kids making something out of not very much. Like this is a photo of our friend Robbie Din, and Robbie in the white singlet there, he has this bike that he rides around all the time, and he's put like a plastic bottle in it to make it sound like a motorbike. It makes a really horrible loud noise, but he really likes it. And all the time he's like fixing his bike, and he just gets like, they sit the bike upside down and then like pedal it while holding onto the wheel and trying not to fall off. And he's very good at finding like interesting different ways to use things and to keep things going in different ways, rather than just say it is a bike, full stop, that is its purpose. And he seems to be able to amuse himself endlessly with quite small things, and it's like always charging his own imagination and reacting to things. And I guess we find this kind of play much more interesting than that which is like designated by the object of play.
It's a short quote, I guess, which just emphasizes that from a play survey conducted in England in 1961, comparing formless playgrounds where everything is created by adults with different types of play, such as the jump playgrounds. Architectural equipment, which was intended to stimulate imaginative games, did not appear to do so. Imagination was more readily sparked off by an old box, sticks, and so on, which came fortuitously to hand, but which the child could manipulate in some way. And at this stage of the project, after being pretty heavily involved in constructing various things ourselves, we would like to take this sort of attitude on more and more, and do our best to hold back from the activity of the playground.
And I guess, yeah, if you look at the playground on a given day, it'll change a lot. So sometimes there'll be a lot of an influx of people and a lot of people on the flying fox and a lot of stimulation, but then a lot of the time it might just be three kids doing this. And we think this is equally valuable and interesting.
And then watch out, because I've got a really grandiose quote, which it's a philosopher that I came across this year who I rather like, and who wrote this book on play comparing. It's called Finite and Infinite Play, and it's juxtaposing these two forms in a very black and white, but eloquent way.
Sort of reads like a manifesto somewhat.
So I guess we'd like to keep thinking about infinite play, as he calls it. And yeah, and I'll just read it. Nice. Infinite planes cannot say when their game began, or do they care? They do not care for the reason that their game is not bounded by time. Indeed, the only purpose of the game is to prevent it from coming to an end, to keep everyone in play. Infinite players continue their play in the expectation of being surprised. If surprise is no longer possible, all play ceases. Surprise causes finite play to end. It is the reason for infinite play to continue. Because infinite players prepare themselves to be surprised by the future, they play in complete openness. It is not an openness as in candor, but an openness as in vulnerability. It is not a matter of exposing one's unchanging identity, the true self that has always been, but a way of exposing one's ceaseless growth, the dynamic self that is yet to be. The infinite player does not expect only to be amused by surprise, but to be transformed by it. For surprise does not alter some abstract past, one's own personal past. To be prepared against surprise is to be trained. To be prepared for surprise is to be educated. Education discovers an increasing richness in the past because it sees what is unfinished there. Training regards the past as finished and the future as to be finished. Education leads towards a continuing self-discovery. Training leads towards a final self-definition. Training repeats a completed past in the future. Education continues an unfinished past into the future.
And I guess also coming back to the juxtaposition between the Frogger playground and Robbie playing with the bike, part of what we are interested in is the idea that play is an approach, an attitude that is extended beyond what's generally designated as play or a playground, and is more an idea that things are unfinished and they don't have a fixed meaning and that they can always be altered and adapted to, and a sort of open-endedness of things that isn't confined to specific spheres of life. So I guess at the end here we've just got a couple of photos of what the playground looks like now. It's been a lot of construction recently. We've just finished building the stage that Jorgen largely built himself, and gradually building up a lot of different elements. Like we've been, all of those bags that we've filled are now kind of banked up on the back there, and have been sort of paper mache over the cement bags, and different people have painted on them and wheat pasted on them. And there's the view of this glad wrap installation that Jorgen made as well, which is sort of a shade cloth and Spider-Man house, as the kids call it.
A couple of photos on the left there of the tunnel that I built that runs underneath the stage. So that was last week, I guess, before the stage was finished. Before I built the stage, the children wanted a tunnel, and the tunnel goes from the sand pit, which is just at the bottom of that slide that you can see on the top left. The tunnel runs from the sandpit underneath the stage and out the other side.
The sand is very popular, perhaps the most popular thing in the playground. I guess to leave off, this is where we're at currently, and we've been doing a lot of building throughout the project, and we've been mostly making things. all of the worst days. But at this stage, we kind of think it's really important to try and back off a bit and just let it be and see what happens. Let the kids respond to that however they want to, and the community, like the space has gradually had more people using it. There are some women who sell Jagoomba Cup over next to that umbrella, and the youth built a badminton court and play badminton every evening. People are often hanging around in the space, and I guess we want to try and remove our influence a bit and just let it be and see what happens. This is a quote from one of the play leaders saying, "One of the great paradoxes in the art of playing with children is that you know you are doing well and you are doing nothing. Doing nothing is the hardest thing of all." So I guess that's what we'll be trying to be doing from now on. And I guess to finish off, we're having like a bit of an open day on the 18th. It'll be fairly unstructured, but we'll have some performances from the kids and some friends on the stage, and flower fight and a water fight and some street food, and it'll be a chance to come and see the playground and use it if you're a kid or an adult who likes using playgrounds, and we'll have some open painting sessions and things like that, and just a bit of a festival atmosphere the afternoon and evening. So if anyone wants to come check the space out, we've got a Facebook invite and some posters which Rhys has possibly put up. And also, yeah, I guess another thing would be to thank both Rhys and Vanny and Risky, who've sort of helped make this possible, like connected us to people and given us a lot of advice and translated various things and found things and helped us out a lot, because we couldn't really, yeah, pretty difficult to do it without them. That's about it.
Thank you very much, Hannah and Jurgen, for sharing with us. Tadi teman-teman diceritain ya, panjang lebar ya, tentang latar belakang kenapa mereka tertarik untuk membuat taman yang kemudian hanya dibikin idenya juga secara bersama dengan anak-anak yang ada di sekitar, lalu kemudian pembangunannya juga bersama-sama dengan masyarakat dan sebagainya. Lokasinya ada di Ratmakan. Kalau yang belum pernah ke sana, itu bisa sampai ke Hotel Mirya Prosani, terus nyebrang, lalu parkir di situ, terus ada tangga turun ke bawah. Jadi playground ini latar belakangnya adalah Hotel Mirya. Jadi ini program yang menarik sekali dan bisa langsung dicoba. Mungkin ada teman-teman yang mau bertanya atau mau komentar atau mau berbagi ide atau menanyakan sesuatu, dipersilakan.
Boleh.
Kalau bisa dalam bahasa Inggris lebih bagus, kalau tidak nanti bisa dibantu. Tapi karena di sini ini ada Mbak Rere ini ya, Mbak, mungkin bisa berbagi. Dipancing Mbak Rere dulu biasanya. Mungkin Mbak Rere mau ada pendapat nih tentang program mereka, atau bagaimana, bisa cerita sedikit.
Monggo. Tempat dapat dengan
anak ini. Nah, kalau ada kenapa lah? My background is urbanist, so I think I will comment like from the urban studies side. But actually, when I hear your presentation, both of your presentation, there is something that aware me. Can you show us the children drawing about what playground they want to be? Yeah. aware me is it's a common background, right? Pakai bahasa Indonesia. Jangan-jangan anak-anak itu sudah kehilangan imajinasinya tentang ruang bermain. So I'm curious, as like, is there, are they losing their imagination about their playground? Because as Jorgen and Hannah said, it's pretty common and, you know, it's usual playground that it's reproducing every place, right? So that's, I think, the main question. Adakah kecil bergerak mau merespon pertanyaanku? Ya, Mbak Riz, that's my pancingan. Ya, apakah benar jika imajinasi itu sudah hilang dari anak-anak, sudah mereka itu udah punya imajinasi lagi tentang playground, sehingga mereka itu perlu diinisiatifin dulu sama anak-anak itu, dan gambar mereka tentang playground kan biasa semua. Both of you came up with a solution. Okay, we'll take that. We build something like flying fox, and that's unusual things in Jogja, right? So what I'm aware of are they using their imagination about playground? So I don't know whether you guys buy something.
The copy, I think that's definitely, like, there's a strong copy trend in the way that the kids are acting, and I think in lots of things they like to copy each other, they like to copy us, and I guess the main way that we've dealt with that is to have a lot of options, a lot of potentials for copy, and then they're choosing between those options, that becomes imagination. And I think that for everyone, like, you're always referring to some previous reference. Most things are not coming, you don't come up with them from scratch, but you have things to draw from to have an imagination.
Yeah, I definitely, I'm attracted to an imagination of all sorts of things, and I don't really believe in people imagining things out of the red. But in regards to this picture, I guess we felt like that was okay. It was only something we attempted very briefly to try and involve them in our project by making a plan like this, because it's not supposed to be a playground that has any sort of plan. We want it to be as unscripted as possible. It's not supposed to be a design that you follow. But this was one sort of very to work out what it was. Personally, in terms of my belief in imagination, I think it has to be much more sort of much more realistically linked to very slow process, and to watch that become something larger and more, I think something much more original and conventional will come out of that approach.
That emulation can be a beginning for imagination as well, but that if you emulate something in an interesting way, it becomes something.
Yeah, I guess my background to have that question is because, not because your project is good at like bringing imagination to children to think something about their space and think something about their things. Yet in our context in globalization, city that full of symbols and more function to be penetrated, we are losing in the bigger city context, yeah, in globalization context, in the space time compressed, hyper symbols like that, and we lose the city itself, losing the nature to imagine. Like, for example, like every city in the world, like, having their own jargon, their own power, their own boleh saya pakai bahasa Indonesia dulu supaya bisa meluruskan ya. Jadi semua kota di zaman globalisasi ini kan berlomba-lomba untuk menjadi sesuatu yang sebenarnya sama. Mereka punya tower sendiri-sendiri, mereka punya aktor internasional, semuanya sama, aesthetic choice-nya sama, ya kan? Kan terus nyapain gitu loh, maksudnya apakah, tidakkah kita berpikir, Joksen dipikirnya itu apa gitu loh, apa arsiteknya atau desainernya atau apanya, itu kok mikirnya semuanya sama ya, kok nggak ada yang beda. Nah, ketika kita tumbuh di lingkungan seperti itu, yang menjadi kekhawatiran saya tadi dan menanyakan pertanyaan itu, jangan-jangan kita teracuni juga gitu loh, teracuni juga dan kita juga tidak bisa berpikir lebih jauh, which is yang Jorgen sama Hana itu mencoba untuk dekonstruksi kembali pikirannya anak-anak di rekaman itu. Fanny, can you translate in English, please?
So Reni was explaining the reason why she asked that kind of question, because she found that nowadays in every series they create the tower, they create the icon, which is like almost similar every year. So she was thinking like, are we like infected by that kind of disease that we were going to be uniform? We have the same idea of architectural space or something like that. And then what you're trying to do is kind of deconstruct that. So when she asked about the design of the playground, and then all the kids are almost the same as your idea, so she was like concerned whether the kids already lost their ability to imagine or fantasize freely of what sort of big playground that they want. Yeah. That was the background of the question. Yeah, but this is not something needs explanation, but probably other friends wants to respond to that, and then I have Tia at my side wants to respond to that.
Yang lain,
Andre.
Kita melakukan imajinasi. Menurut saya mereka punya imajinasi, anak kecil pasti punya imajinasi ya. Cuma mungkin pendekatannya yang kurang, nggak tahu itu kurang tepat atau gimana. Kalau mereka dikasih sumber kertas dan pensil untuk menggambarkan playground, kemungkinan semuanya akan berimajinasi hanya sama kalau playground itu seperti itu. Ya tadi yang Mbak Rere bilang, di mana-mana menciptakan hal yang sama, nah, otomatis playground itu sama-sama dan mereka mewacanakan playground yang sama. Tapi kalau gimana kalau anak kecil itu diumbar di lapangan dengan banyak benda, itu kemungkinan mereka akan menciptakan playground yang berbeda itu dibanding dengan sumber sepas.
So yes, that probably if you have like a bunch of kids and then you present with a piece of paper and pencil, then if you ask them like draw your playground, your version of playground, most likely they will make something the same, because like that is what is put on a lot of advertisement about this is a proper playground, it's like this, yeah. But then if you put a bunch of kids in a vacant lot and then you provide them with lots of things, then probably they will create their own things, which is not as what they have in their mind as a proper playground. Yeah, that's her response. And then Fanny said that probably Rizky can share something. Because Rizky was there at the time that we tried to get ideas of what is their imaginary or ideal playground be like.
Okay. Jadi kalau bicara tentang gambar dan imajinasi anak, itu emang kaitannya tuh jadi gini, waktu itu kan emang anak-anak dikumpulkan dan disuruh silahkan kalian gambar apapun, terserah kalian kalau playground tuh kayak gimana. Nah mungkin benar sih kata mbaknya bilang kalau mungkin anak-anak tuh bayangannya playground tuh ya kayak gitu. Nah terlebih lagi sebenarnya Jorgen itu sudah bawa gambar dulu untuk apa dikasih tahu ke anak-anak. Nah kira-kira tuh seperti ini. Nah ternyata mereka tuh kurang pede untuk menggambarkan sesuatu yang baru, dan terus malah seperti banyak mencontoh gambarnya Jorgen. Jadi untuk apa dikaitkan dengan imajinasi, benar yang apa dibilang tadi kayak lebih efektif kalau ada banyak barang, dan memang itu terjadi di sana, dan menurut itu hal yang sangat menarik untuk di apa namanya dilihat juga. Jadi tidak ada yang nyuruh untuk ini itu, tapi memang apa anak-anaknya juga aku pengen bikin ini, ya silakan mau bikin ini, dan itu terjadi kok di sana. Ya, yeah, I talk about the way the children drawing playground sketch, and then it's about how they copy your drawing, your and it becomes what's it? The first way we gather the ideas of playground, and then finally we decide. You two decide that it's more effective than the most effective way is by what's it? Having a lot of communication rather than just drawing, right?
Different kinds, and I think it's a time thing as well, because I think that they think that we are wanting them to emulate us perhaps, and that's what they're trying to please us a little bit when we don't know each other so well. And I think that a lot of you need to give time. I don't think they don't have imagination. I think that it's there. It just takes a bit of time to have the confidence to give that idea or whatever. And I think the time thing is very important with this.
Jadi untuk teman-teman yang pengen ngerti atau kemudian seperti apa sih prosesnya di Ratmakan, silahkan datang tanggal 18 Oktober. Itu nanti acaranya itu juga diserahkan kepada mereka, yang mereka dengan konsepnya sendiri mereka bikin party seperti apa dan sebagainya. Mau nambah sedikit? Go.
Great things about this project is one, that you deconstruct their mind or deconstruct what they think when they think about space, and at the same time you encourage them to have consciousness about their the neighborhood, the space, and the urban. That's I think the great things of this project.
Dan apa kita cukup ini ya, aku pakai bahasa Indonesia.
Jurgen sama Hana. Ini memang menarik sekali karena namanya memang Taman Berhubung, jadi membiarkan semuanya ada prosesnya. Jadi mulai dari nggak ada apa-apa, terus tumbuh, terus akhirnya menjadi apa itu. Bahkan misalnya ketika kita setiap kali kita datang ke sana, terus kok tiba-tiba udah ada ini apa namanya flying fox. Kemudian anak-anak pengennya misalnya dia pakai, mereka pengen buat mainan yang kayak politik yang terus kita yang lempar-lemparin bunder-bunder gitu loh, tengok nanti itu bunder-bunder. Nah itu mereka buat itu juga. Kemudian pas kita kesana lagi, kok anda-anda mau sama terowongan, kok anda-anda mau sama pemain apa itu. Ya menariknya itu, jadi kita apa ya, secara konsep secara ini support ya, dan juga itu bermanfaat bagi teman-teman di Kampung Rahmatan, karena teman-teman di Kampung Rahmatan dengan background yang secara pendidikan misalnya kebanyakan misalnya adalah lulusan SMP, SMA atau orang kerja atau misalnya apa ya, gendong-gendong lah loh. Nah, walaupun kan memang mereka gendong-gendong loh ya, itu sangat menarik. Dan ada tempat hangout juga, jadi ada tempat nongkrong yang dibuat bersama-sama oleh para pemuda kampung. Dan walaupun bermain kuah udah lo saya cium pengopong tapi nih mereka tempat nongkrongan lo, jadi orang pokok. Artinya sebenarnya program Taman Bertumbuh ini menjadi semacam trigger atau pemicu bagi teman-teman pemuda kampung Rahmatan yang awalnya mereka tidak terlalu aktif. Artinya kegiatan kampung itu yang 17-an kampungan orang cuma pemuda, tapi pemuda yang membuat ya mau 17-an roh, tapi ketika ada teman-teman ini mereka lebih apa ya, open menerima banyak sekali perbedaan-perbedaan yang ada. Walaupun mungkin tidak dipungkiri selama 2 bulan ini ada banyak konflik atau ada banyak apa ya, ya gesekan-gesekan antara teman-teman pemuda atau misalnya dengan Jurgen dan Anan dengan teman-teman atau warga di sekitar, misalnya kasus itu ya. Oh ya, ada banyak yang lucu, misalnya kayak ada pohon pisang tuh tadi. Nah, pohon pisang itu menarik karena teman-teman pemuda bilang, "Wes ditebang wae, kok ini ra nganggo. Wes gedange iki apa gedang mati, terus baru iki gedang sing ono jenenge iki. Nah, gedang rutuk. Wes ora." Terus mereka jangan ditebang, terus dielu-elu ngono kayak pohon ini. Maksudnya itu sangat menarik karena terus akhirnya tetap ditebang karena pemuda jombak-jombak pokoknya lucu lah. Tapi menarik sekali ketika ada banyak gesekan, ada banyak hal-hal yang memang berbeda, itu kita terasa banget. Artinya memang tidak dipungkiri program ini juga ada banyak sekali, walaupun pada akhirnya berhasil membuat sebuah taman yang memang bagus sekali untuk anak-anak, kemudian bisa tempat nongkrong, kemudian bahkan mbak-mbak yang senangnya dangdutan, ya bisa ada kuno dangdutan berbengi atau ngombe, apa yang saya menunggu, atau pi, tapi paling enggak apa ya, bisa menghidupkan kembali apa ruang-ruang yang mati atau ruang-ruang yang apa ya, vakum, apa ya, vacant lot ya, yang tak terpakai, itu menarik. Itu menarik sih menurut kita dari teman-teman kecil bergerak. Apa? Ini akan diperbagus, membuat ini bla bla. Nah, tapi terus gimana tuh?
Itu kan terus Bu RW itu bilang apa? Awalnya tuh pesimis kalau misalnya mereka bisa bikinnya gitu, dan ternyata pas kesana lihat jadinya tuh bagus, dan itu Bu RW-nya itu bilang kalau oh, ini mereka tuh nih ada dari organ disuruh membuat kayak jurnal atau apa tulisan tentang ya nama ini kedepannya mau diapain, dan kan dibawa oleh Bu RW ke Hongkong untuk diajukan ke sana dan mungkin akan katanya dapat bantuan dana dan lain-lain, tapi menurut saya bilang ke mereka tuh ya itu nggak masalah karena emang yang kami yang mereka pengen itu kita mereka bikin sesuatu dan itu apa membuat apa ya satu yang baru bukan terus apa cari bantuan.
Oh, ya sekali ya itu nanti terserah
wait
ya nanti
balik juga kan sebagai
ambang-ambang ya jadi tapi itu nanti terserah teman-teman sih karena teman-teman diranakan maksudnya ini akan seperti apa karena memang dari bangunan kita sih
papa,
memang apa
ini untuk papa aja
membebaskan dalam arti ini mau teman-teman ramakan mau gimana itu mau kesepakatan teman-teman juga gitu sih. Oh, it's very long, ya.
Ya, yang terutama yang terakhir.
And then she also told that there are some, this program is not work smoothly. There's also some friction, like when the youth said that you can cut off all the banana tree, but then some of the people, they don't want the banana tree to be cut off, and then they hug it, so that kind of drama and stuff like that.
No, it's
not.
Because first day, I couldn't know what would be cut.
You said that the young people said that, oh yeah, just cut it up because it's the banana tree is not the fruit banana, it's the one with lots of seed. Yeah. But then like some of the people said that, yeah. Or you defend, oh yeah, you're the one who defend the banana tree, that's why like you relocate it elsewhere, right? Yeah, stuff like that. And then there's a question whether they're going to be like another aspect of it. I said, will someone will take benefit of your project? And then Christy said that, yeah, one of the lady said that probably you can write something like a proposal or a report of what you did, and probably she can bring it up to the, don't know, the government, so that they can get some money, funding, or stuff like that.
We haven't heard about that.
Yeah, that's what they said, pretty much.
I'd like to ask a rather personal question that probably won't be so much anymore. You mentioned that you haven't been working much with children before, and I was wondering if you return or do you plan to travel, your next plans, and how is this experience might alter you or you know develop something from within your practice as an artist?
I'm not sure at this stage. In terms of working with children, I feel like that I'm probably for another 2 months here. And I'm looking forward to adopting a less constructive or being less focused on the construction and being able to think more in terms of pedagogy. There's a lot of, I'm really interested in art pedagogy, but I don't know exactly how. I would like to try and work
I've done bits and pieces working with the Ogden with an art collective in Hobart, but it's not something that is that I have any kind of basis in. And I found it quite fun. I'm probably interested in fucking around with that a bit more. But and also I think that the urban stuff I still find interesting and maybe like to learn more about. But probably neither of us are very good at making strong future plans like this far in advance. I don't know. I think it was interesting trying to start something up like from scratch at this scale, because this is the largest kind of project that I've ever been involved in, and some of it worked and some was really hard. but I think that maybe next time I'd like to try something, just some small scale things with similar kind of ideas. I'm definitely interested in this kind of like helping from behind this kind of ideas, and I guess that working with people in this kind of way, like the methodological things, I think I'd like to take on with any other project that I did, but possibly like topics or people that you work with or whatever will vary a fair bit. That's kind of hard to say at this point. But,
I have a question, but for proyek ini apakah dipertimbangkan keberlanjutannya, karena mengingat proyeknya itu berupa fasilitas untuk masyarakat ya, khususnya anak kecil lagi. Itu akankah itu berlanjut, dan kalau iya, itu apa kegiatannya itu akan sejauh apa ya?
So she's asking about like what is the next plan with this project from Kecil Bergerak and GIRP, like how, because like this is a facility for public and all fun.
Ya sih, jadi seperti yang tadi saya bilang, setelah sebenarnya namanya juga kan bertumbuh ya, yang dikatakan bertumbuh sih. Hanan dan Jordan sudah menginisiasi sesuatu. Mbak Des, translate. Jadi seperti yang tadi saya sudah bilang bahwa nanti terserah teman-teman
peraturan.
Jadi kalau kita tuh bukan yang kayak kita terus wah ini anu bro ini gini kok, enggak, kita selama ini enggak pernah ngarang-ngarain atau kita enggak pernah apa ya, wah ini enaknya apa, tapi kesepakatan mereka sendiri. Misalnya si Ersa itu jadi koordinator kampung, dia berencana akan membuat angkringan misalnya, dia akan berjualan di situ, kemudian akan lebih membutuhkan lagi. Nah dan kalau kita artinya kalau tapi teman Kecil Bergerak kan memang punya banyak jaringan di kampung-kampung pemuda ya, itu tidak secara langsung maksudnya terus apa ya, kita tuh berteman-teman, jadi datang lebih pada kayak nongkrong bareng, kemudian ini mana apa yang bisa di jadi bukan yang kayak LSM, maksudnya kan kalau misalnya kayak gitu ngomongin tentang keberlangsungan kan terus ini apa program ini apa program lagi, kita lebih free flow, artinya lebih terserah teman-teman ini mau jadi gimana, ini enaknya gimana, terus mungkin kita datang ke pas rapatnya, terus jadi benar-benar terserah teman-teman. Tapi ya kita akan terus bergerak, kalau enggak cuma di satu kampung aja, nanti bisa di lain.
Dan juga sebenarnya kenapa kemudian kita bikin presentasinya sekarang ya?
Kenapa kita bikin presentasinya sekarang setelah kemudian apa? Memang ini tidak akan pernah selesai, tapi tumbuhnya lumayan lah gitu. Sudah ada akarnya, sudah ada daun, sudah ada cabang seperti itu. Dan kita bikin presentasi seperti ini tujuannya sebenarnya kita tuh mau menularkan apa yang sudah dimulai sama mereka. Di awalnya waktu akan residensi kita tawarkan untuk presentasi duluan untuk kenalan sama Jogja, terus kemudian teman-teman di Jogja, Atsin, kolektif gitu. Tapi kemudian mereka lebih pede kalau ini kita kerja dulu aja. supaya kemudian idenya itu sudah terbukti bisa dijalankan atau enggak, lalu hasilnya seperti apa, lalu kemudian ini amat sangat terbuka untuk diduplikasi oleh siapapun. Bahkan ketika mereka masih di sini, kalau misalnya ada yang mau lihat dong, terus mau tanya, mau ngobrol, caranya gimana, ininya apa, itu terbuka sekali. So I was telling them that the reason why we do this presentation is that then anyone can duplicate this. And then when you are here, then they can probably like themselves and talk, and then that's the reason why we also do the, why you also do the open day. Right. So they can have the idea that, oh yeah, from nothing they become something, and then it's growing, and it keeps growing, then you just want to see it. Okay, mungkin sampai di sini dulu teman-teman. Saya ingatkan lagi, semuanya diundang, silahkan ngajak teman-teman sebanyak-banyaknya untuk datang ke, namanya jadi alun-alun Ratmakan, tanggal 18 sore. Gratis, tidak dipungut biaya, tapi akan lebih baik kalau teman-teman membawa buku bekas, karena kemudian dari Kampung Ratmakan diidekan untuk membuat perpustakaan. Terima kasih sekali, bisa minta tepuk tangannya untuk Yorin dan Yorin.